So, before we talk about dependence injection, let me share something about Kotlin and myself. So, I started writing Kotlin basically 2 years ago after I came to DroidCon. I heard about Kotlin before and it was amazing. And then I went to DroidCon and I talked to developers and I had a feeling I'm the last person on earth not using Kotlin. I know we are in this bubble, right? I just talked to the right people, but it was very fortunate. So next week, me and my colleague sitting over there, we just switched to Kotlin in production. And went very well. And it still is there from what I heard from Tomek, who's now having my code base. But Kotlin in the end, after Google I/O, it kicked off. We saw this also in a survey, right? And then something interesting happened. So a lot of discussion happened about dependency injection and how to use it in Kotlin. And I realized at some point, okay, something's going on there. Maybe let's give a talk about it. And I looked a bit into what's going on there. I gave an earlier version of this talk a few months ago. And when I did that, Tassin basically tweeted this. Wait, to inject or not to inject? Is there any doing this? I didn't. That would be silly, right? Well, they are doing football, we do a little, like, Shakespeare.
You have to post for a photo.
Okay, I will. So, let's set up a stage. That's what's going on, because we're in the middle of the thing. Okay, to inject or not to inject, that is the question. Whether it's noble in the mind to suffer the slings and arrows of a Java world, or to take arms against a sea of daggers, and by opposing, end them, to die, to sleep. Okay, I think I should stay a developer, right? No, let's start with the actual talk. So what was happening when I wanted to give this talk was that basically every week I saw an article like this. Hey, do Kotlin dependency injection with a reader monad. Hey, how to reproduce Dagger with Kotlin. Hey, here's a new framework called Capsule. Hey, here's a new framework called Coin. Hey, here's a new framework called Codeine. And so on and so on. So something was definitely happening. But on the other hand, we had famous people from the community tweeting stuff like this. Is this really dependency injection? I don't think so. And we had Jake Wharton saying, this is a service locator, don't touch that. So something was going on, which even more I wanted to look into this. And before we can start talking about this, why I think people wanted something different, and what is about this service locator discussion, right? We have to go back a bit back in time. Because I turned 40 last weekend, so I've been in Java for some time, but some maybe even directly started with Kotlin, so they don't know where the whole dependency injection of Java came from, right? So let's do a little time travel. So let's start long before Java and start with the word new, the keyword new. That's how you start every talk about dependency injection, because nothing says implementation more than a new keyword, right? Very early we realized that's not a good idea, it's not testable, right? Your code should do more than, like, a different thing than just creating instances, and you should do only one thing. So in 1994, this design patent book by the Gang of Four came out, told us a lot of ways how to create, to replace the new, or hide the new, like factories and stuff like this. And then we had Java at some point, and by the end of the 90s, factories were the thing. There were factories all over the place. And then in the early 2000s, by then we had Java, we have Java 1.3. First other patterns came up, there was things called locators, so the whole service locator thing maybe started there. Definitely what people use were this large Godzilla factory calls, that the train wreck calls that are like violating the law of Demeter. You saw them a lot back then. And what I found interesting, and I forgot at least about that, Java 1.3, you could define in your manifest of a jar an implementation and an interface, and then later asked, hey, service loader, give me this class. So that is kind of the way it was used later. What was definitely happening is the first dependency injection frameworks popped up. They weren't called like this back then. They were called inversion of control containers. And then at some point, Martin Fowler, I think, came up with the name dependency injection. At least made it famous. 2003, the dawn of dependency injection. Spring came. Some people probably disagree now. They say, hey, Spring and Juice were at the same time. Not really true. The Juice maybe was started, but was internally only in the beginning. And they had an interesting idea. They said, you know, the whole configuration of how to create instances, let's move them out of the code. And they moved them into XML. And then you would just ask for an implementation. And you would use, at some point, annotation. Java 5 gave us annotations. Who remembered the time before Java 5? Not many, so lucky you. So we got this auto-wired annotation in Spring, very similar to what is now at Inject. And then 2007, Juice came. What was interesting was that they reverted this XML thing. I mean, XML wasn't a thing anymore. And you would write this configuration in part of the code. So a little step back to where we came from. And 2010, the whole thing was standardized. So if you nowadays use like an add inject, it comes from this package, Java X inject. That is a standard, right? Dagger, toothpick, juice, they all apply to this. This was a very important step because they got replaceable by each other, right? So Android was started. So we needed dependency injection on Android. So we got RoboJuice, started by the community, by a guy called Michael Burton. I think he's now at Google. There was a problem with this. It was basically like Juice, just for Android. But it was reflection-based, and Google said, don't use it. They actually said, don't use dependency injection frameworks, because it was the only one that we had by then, and a few clones. There was a problem, but this reflection is super slow in Android, and we didn't realize in the beginning. Maybe you saw a talk, I'm not sure if it's online, but the slides are. Stefan Nicholas, the guy who was the maintainer of RoboJuice at some point, he gave a talk and looked into what's actually slow in reflection on Android. That was very interesting. So asking for a field or setting a field is actually not that slow. It's like maybe 4 times slower than using it via code. What's actually super slow is calling new instance. It's like hundreds of times slower. He didn't know by then why, but he expected something in index format is probably the issue. But this is what a dependency injection framework does, right? It creates instances, a graph full of instances. That's why it becomes unmaintainable slow, and Google said, that's not the way to go. Happily, we got Dagger. Initially, it came from Square. They basically said, you know, it's similar to Juice, but they did some other routes. And they moved away from this reflection approach. So that there was an annotation processor, and things were basically generated. Code generation came in via annotation. Not completely, and the generated code is very ugly if you ever had to debug it. But we had something that we could actually use on Android. And because of those drawbacks, Google took over, gave us a Dagger tool, fixed those drawbacks, complete validation is done on compile time. Everyone lived happily ever after, right? OK, until Google Android, Dagger Android came out, some Android extensions to fix some of the boilerplate that we had to write. So this is where we're coming from, right? So let's start talking about annotation processing. That's nice, right? We do it all over the place nowadays. And that's why I want to talk about it. I like this tweet from an ex-colleague of mine. He said, you know, in the old days, if you did something twice, you would extract a class. Nowadays, you write an annotation processor. And it really became like this. There were, like, I don't know, architecture components, the lifecycle observer. There's an annotation processor behind it. It's like a class with, like, 5 methods. So it became the thing. But there's a problem with this. One is build time impact. So every single annotation processor has an impact on your build time. If you went to the Gradle talk, you might have heard that since Gradle 4.7 and then 4.6 was experimental, it was for the first time the possibility to write an incremental annotation processor. It wasn't even possible before. So every time it compiles the whole thing and generates the whole thing. And we added more and more annotation processors. So when I was working at Viacom, we love data binding. I still love it, but it's very slow. And we started, okay, we have to compensate with this. So we start kicking off annotation processors just to gain back some of the build time. And even now that Gradle supports it, it will take time. I think there's a pull request open for Butterknife. I think some of the other ones are early adopters. Dagger is looking into it, but probably won't never be completely incremental the way it just works. Auto value needs to wait to Gradle 4.8 because they're missing something. So it will take a long time until we have really incremental annotation processing. So that's an issue. So maybe we can question, or some of us question annotation processor a bit. So what else do we have? Especially looking at something like Dagger, a lot of people don't like the magic behind it. Okay, what is going on here? A bit related to annotation processing, right? Also, maybe back to simplicity, maybe that's where all these frameworks appeared. I don't know. You definitely can say that annotation processing came a bit because of the lack of the Java language. So it gave us something that Java couldn't give us. So we have Kotlin now. And Kotlin brought a lot of things that we don't have in Java. There's lazy. They're delegates, so lazy is a delegate. So you can write your own delegates. Type inference, cool thing. The whole inlining with the reified, so you can ask a generic actually for its type. This is super awesome. Lambdas, all the functional programming. And especially if you look into functional programming, dependency injection changes. It's a function. So, and at some point it disappears. There are like nice articles about, I think it's one is called from Mark Zeman, from dependency injection to dependency rejection. But it's so deep into functional programming, I don't understand it. So if you understand monads, maybe you can start reading this, but it's like complex stuff. But functional programming changes things. So what, at least in my opinion, what I think, were other problems people and developers saw between the dependency injection that was made for Java when they moved to Kotlin? And I've been there. I mean, I used Java dependency injection like Dagger in Kotlin. So let's look at some. Let's look at the constructor. So you have a view model there. It takes like a use case. That's nice Kotlin code, right? Let's use this in dependency injection. You know, you have to add inject, that's of course, but then you have to use this constructor keyword that we don't need otherwise. That makes my Kotlin code ugly. I don't want that. Kotlin is so concise, that's what I like it. And there's more. Default arguments, such a nice thing, right? If you don't pass it, it will use something. Yeah, injected, not possible. It's generated Java code, it doesn't see your default arguments. So you have to have a second constructor, which is not a thing anymore in Kotlin. Makes it ugly again. So let's look at some, like the injected fields. I could write this without injection, right? Val by lazy and then get it from somewhere. I want to inject this. I have to make the late init var. It already looks ugly. Late init, if you don't know Kotlin, basically means, believe me, you cannot check that I'm setting it, but I'm actually setting it at some point before I use it. And maybe you saw it. It's not private anymore. One of the things that we gave up with stuff like Dagger, with the code generation, is encapsulation. RoboJuice didn't have this issue, they were fiction-based. The fields were private. We don't remember this anymore, but we made all our fields public for annotation processing. So some of the frameworks came up, and I want to have a look at two of them and compare them a bit versus the way the typical Java dependency injection. So let's look at some use cases. So this is the way you would inject with something like Dagger, right? Any Java DI, because @inject is coming from that specification, from the JSR 330. Let's do this with Codein, one of those frameworks. You would say, it's a var, it can be private if you want to, and I would say, by Codein instance. So that's, they're using a delegate here. Very similar in Coin, so I'm just looking at those two, but they're all very similar. They have a by inject, that looks even nicer. I can make it private if I want to. And it's a var, it's not a var, it's final. You want everything to be final, right? Let's look at the bindings. So how would you bind the things that you want to inject? Here I have to stop using Dagger because I don't want to space like five slides just to show you how to do one binding. I'm looking at another framework that I really like. It's called Toothpick, also like a Java dependency injection. So in Kotlin you would do something like this. Bind, there's this interface API, for example. Bind this API class to this dummy implementation. Actually, this is part of my code. For like 2 months, I didn't have the real API. I would just have like a fake version of this while I was coding. And then I have some data binding stuff that I'm also binding. So for the first, I'm binding to a class. For the other one, I'm binding to an instance, so singleton. So here it started. I started this new project, and I decided to use not to use Dagger, but Toothpick, which I used before as well. And I didn't like that code. It still looks ugly. So first thing I did, writing some Kotlin extension around this. I'll share the link later. everybody needs Kotlin extensions, right? So this looks much nicer, it looks more Kotlin-like. So now, same thing, bind class, API, to the dummy API class, or the bind an instance. It's very easy to do in Kotlin. And Java 8 a bit moves in the direction with the refactor types and stuff like this. So this looks better, but how would this look in the pure Kotlin versions, right? So let's look at Codeine. Very similar, actually. Bind the generic with a provider, and then you can pass like a nice lambda. The same, they have a nice keyword with singleton, so it's very obvious that this is a singleton. One thing to notice here, we are not passing a class thing there. We will come back to this later. So we're passing two instances here, but one with a lambda. Coin, basically same thing. They have the nice thing with Coin is it's very simple. They only have like three keywords. So there's factory and bean. Bean is a singleton. And they're actually changing them because I always mix them up and probably others too. So in Coin 1.0, this will be a single, the bean, for example. But very similar, right? And this looks basically like the Kotlin extension that we had. Not so much difference. But as I mentioned, those do not have dummy API class. The reason is simple. They don't use an annotation processing. So those new frameworks, they're just normal code. There's no annotation processing involved. That means they can't generate stuff for you. So let's talk about constructors and those inject annotated constructors that we're using, right? So it is very handy, right, to mark your constructor with an inject in Java and Kotlin, and he knows exactly which one to use. I personally, and I met other people too, have a bit of a problem with this. I think it violates a bit separation of concerns and clean architecture. Why? Because you're basically spitting this inject all over your place. When you do clean architecture by Uncle Bob, your dependency injection would only sit in the outermost layer. No one else inside, there is no injection in there. But we would put the inject all over the place. It's a very typical thing. We do this in the back end Java as well. And when you talk to developers, they're mostly fine with this, yeah? But it's from the standard thing. It doesn't do anything, right? But yeah, I had a bad feeling about it. I did it. I used it exactly like this. It got even worse when we had, like, you can have an singleton annotation in your class, right? So you're telling someone how to use this with an annotation. I didn't really like it. I think the so-called providers are a nicer way, which is just an interface that you can implement that creates you an instance. It's also part of the standard. So this is the way Toothpick did it. So if you need a home view model, you could define a provider, home view model provider, and then implement, it's basically a class that creates you a view model. At least you could use the inject there, then it stays in your injection layer. I like that. So you can keep it out of the actual classes and still use the thing. But you have to declare one of them each, right? Still a bit different in the Kotlin world because there's nothing generated. They also use the with provider here in Codeine, and you would pass this lambda, right? And home view model needed an argument, so in Codeine you just say instance. The compiler knows what type it is. That's one of the nice things with Kotlin, right? You don't have to specify types. So it will look up this and then search for the provider or the definition, the binding for this parameter. The same with coin, there's a get, which looks nice. Same thing, this is how he gets argument, and so he builds up this graph. But you have to write it yourself, right? If you have 10 parameters, you have to write 10 times instance. So, all not a big thing, right? It's very similar, a bit more code that we have to write in Kotlin, and we are getting some performance back. So what's the problem? So let's come back to the initial tweets that I showed you. So let's talk about dependency injection versus service locators. And this is actually a discussion that happened, and that's why we went back in time, that happened in the early 2000s, or the mid-2000s. That's where it started, and then came back later, first in Java world, and then in .NET world. So let's talk about this. And let's do some archaeology, and the guy who will first answer this is Martin Fowler, who will help us, because he wrote about this. He had this famous article, a very long one, about dependency injection service locators in the early 2000s. And here's this example in there. So Java code, you can see, tell by the semicolon, right? So there's this movie lister class that he needs, and the movie lister needs a movie finder, That's a full example. Very easy, right? So how do we get a movie lister? So with dependency injection, so he used this Pico, one of those frameworks back then, and he also showed how to do it manually. Similar to as we showed it in the other binding set, you would register some implementations. So you would say a movie finder, there's an implementation called colon movie finder, and the movie lister you can use directly. It's a class, it's not an interface. So you register both, and then you can just ask the framework, and it would create you one with the constructor injection. This is all you need to know about dependency injection. That's how it works. And that's how it works in a graph. So the movie lister needs a movie finder, just knows the interface, and there's one class, this assembler, how we called it, that creates you one. Service locators are not that different, he said. But there is another actor here. So the movie lister would ask the service locator, give me a movie finder. And then that same thing would happen. So the assembler would create you one. And it would look like this in the code. He had like a locator where you also had to define those two. So service locator and the code. So he creates a service locator, he gives them a finder, and then he has this method movie finder. So very simple self-written one. There are no frameworks involved here. So basically, Martin summed it up like this. You know, both provide the same fundamental decoupling. And both variations, application code is independent of the concrete implementation. This is what you want to achieve, right? But there's a fundamental difference, he said. And this is how you use it. With the service locator, the class asks for it. Well, in the injection, there's no explicit requests. That's why very often dependency injection is explained as the following the Hollywood rule. Don't call us, we call you. So with a service locator, you had another problem because the class asked for it. Every client of the service locator has a direct dependency to the locator. So Martin says, in the end, the decision between locator and injector is if you care about this. So he doesn't see it, didn't saw it much as a problem back then. Actually said, you know, dependency injection comes with a price too. It tends to be very hard to understand and hard to debug. So actually, Martin Fauna was a bit of a fan of a service locator, which is like the big anti-pattern it became later. So why are we actually talking about it? I mean, thinking of this example, it is just the initial creating of this movie lister, right? So how do we create this one class? Everything else, we use the constructors, right? And if we just would use constructor injection, we wouldn't even probably talking about this. But the problem is that on Android, there are a lot of classes where you cannot use constructor injection. That's why we're here. That's why we're back on the same place where Java was in the early 2000s. So we have to use field injection. We have activities, services, so classes where we don't control the construction because they are lifecycle components. And when it comes to field injection, things are a bit different. So let's look a bit deeper into examples again, now that we have this knowledge about SL and TI. So add inject, right? The example I showed it before. This is obvious dependency injection, right? Totally. Let's do something like this. By lazy, locator, give me a binder factory. I guess that's obvious. I even called it locator. That's a service locator. Let's look at another example. What's with this? By inject. Is it a service locator or is it dependency injection? Now I would say it depends. Probably we have to look behind at behind the inject what it does. So I can only decide when looking behind the delegate. But isn't it the same as with Dagger, where someone creates me code and I need to look into it and see how it works? So maybe it could be that Dagger generates me code in there, right, to get. So there's a lot of discussions going on, as I said. So let's look into those discussions. So Jake Wharton, he said, you recognize Jake Wharton? So Dagger, at some point, he said, Dagger is a service locator. That sentence continues, but we will stop here for now. So when you think about this, Dagger is a service locator. Because in the generated code, he will go to something and will get a class from there. And let's go to another guy, Mark Zeman. He came back to this problem of service locators in .NET, so he wrote famous books about that. He said he didn't like some of the definitions from Fuller, and he said, just because an API looks like a service locator doesn't have to mean it is one. Interesting. Because Why did he say that? Basically, Martin Fowler said, you cannot implement dependency injection most of the time without having a service locator inside, because that's the thing that you ask for dependency, right? And Maximin didn't like that because he doesn't like service locators. So he changed his definition. Basically, what he's saying is, it becomes a service locator if you use it incorrectly. So when an application code, as opposed to infrastructure code, is querying the service, then it is a service locator. So that thing under the hood that Martin says is a service locator, he called it a composition root. And there are developers who use Dagger, for example, in the service locator way. I was surprised. They would not use the add inject part. They would directly ask Dagger for something. By Maximin, this is a service locator. So it's not about the mechanics itself. It's about the role that defines if it's an injector or locator. So let's go back to Jake. So he said it's a service locator, but one that forces requests to a public API. And the difference for Jake, for service locators, is that there the dependencies are no longer part of any API contract. And this is basically exactly what Marcus Ehmann meant. He gave this example that it's a very typical service locator API. If you have something like this, right, a create that is generic. That's basically Max Ehmann said, if you use this, this violates like everything we know about object orientation, because there's no contract there, right? This is not an API a client should actually consume. But this is what is used inside the infrastructure code. So let's look at what Codeine and Coin are doing under the hood. Let's look behind the add inject, by inject. You will find something like this. So this is, the whole thing is based on inline reified logic, so it will only work in Kotlin. And it would resolve this generic T by class. This is pretty much what we just saw, right? So does it mean that Codeine and Coins are service locators? Question mark. You could argue that this is infrastructure code. This is not your own code pulling there, right? So let's leave this discussion for now and go back and ask the owners itself. So Codeine has actually an FAQ about this because it's a hot topic. So they say, you know, we are not dependency injection, but we are not service locator. We are a dependency retrieval container. So they found a new term. I think when you Google for it, you only find that FAQ. But they say, and this, I like this, so injection is more pure. Totally clear, they say, but it has less features. And retrieval is much easier. But yeah, it requires the class to know about Codeine. And in the end, and I'm just quoting them here, it boils down to that question, do you need this class to be Codeine independent? This sounds pretty much what Martin Fowler said back in the day, right? About the direct dependency to the service locator. The nice thing is that they continue and showing you, but you can write code like this. So you can get the byte Codeine thing out and wrap it somewhere and use just a lazy delegate. And then you can replace at one point what is your injection. It is more code, obviously, so it's not as elegant anymore. But they show you a way if you want to make it independent, which is nice. So let's go back to Android and Jake. Basically, he said, you know, in the end, let's not discuss about this, if it's good or bad. Let's look at the use cases. So you can write the whole thing yourself. It's called pure injection by Maximin, for example. It used to be poor man's injection, but it sounds bad. But you can write dependency injection yourself. And if you have no idea about dependency injection, I always encourage you, do it. Write it yourself, because then you understand the magic behind it. So manual injection has basically zero fixed cost. It just scales poorly. If you use the service locator approach, he believes, there's some overhead in creating it, like writing the bindings and doing the lookup. And dependency injection has a lot of overhead up front. And setting up the whole hierarchy, right? Those huge components in there that I didn't even show you because it would take like multiple slides. All the modules and the bindings, so there's a lot of overhead here. But Jake believes that if you're writing a serious application with hundreds of bindings, and hundreds of injected types, you want something like a real dependency injection. I would add here, this is only true if you use the add inject constructor. So if those things get generated by you, right? If you start creating them yourself, is it still the same thing? Mark Zeman would actually say, yeah, but you know, without this auto-wiring thing, whole dependency injection container doesn't make any sense. Then write it yourself. So different meanings here. Opinions. So, where are we now? Halfway through the talk. You know, the choice depends on the scale. That's what Jake said. You definitely have this hard dependency to codeine, coin, whatever, if you start using it. The performance is basically the same. But you get compile time validation, right? This is the one thing that Jake says that is actually really important. Because Dagger checks everything. Else, you have crashes runtime. But this is not dependency injection specific. If you use a toothpick, they're using code generation, but not everything is. They're more like Dagger 1. Something is at runtime. So is compile time validation the one thing that should make this decision for us? And actually, when writing this talk, I thought, this reminds me of something. There was a blog a while ago that caused a lot of discussions where someone asked, and maybe you can guess who it was, whose job is this to manage the nulls? So you can guess it's about Kotlin here. The language or the programmer? You know, defects are the fault of a programmer. So it's the programmer who creates those defects, not the language. And what is the programmer supposed to do to prevent defects? Write tests, and this is the guy who wrote it. So let's talk about tests. Talk about tests in a minute, but this block continues. So I thought it is very similar to the compile time safety for dependency injection, right? That block continues, and the next part is even more fitting. So why did the nuclear power plant in Chernobyl catch fire, melt down, destroy the small city, and leave a large area uninhabitable? Because someone overrode all the safeties. There were safeties in place. So maybe don't depend on safeties to prevent catastrophes. That's what you should use tests for. If you have tests, you get the same safety. So let's talk about tests. So I was moving to Coin in the current project after I did this toothpick initially. And Coin, for example, has a nice dry run. It's a method you can call and will validate your graph if you have everything you need. It's not complete safe because you might still want to inject something that is not part of the graph. But the one side is tested. The other side should be in your tests, right? So normally you should have a test per fragment activity. It just spawns up the thing and sees everything is there. So, especially when you do TDD, which hopefully you all joined the TDD talk I gave 2 days ago. But there's more. So in Coin, and now I keep for Coin, codeine is probably similar, but I have experience with Coin, so I can tell you about this. You can overwrite very easily dependencies in a test. It's something that actually Dagger is really, really bad with, because you cannot overwrite easily. That's why actually on the Dagger side it says don't use it in tests. So Coin and others are made for this. So you could just overwrite one, for example, with this load coin module. Actually, it looks a bit ugly, so what we did at our company, we wrote like a test extension. If you don't know JUnit 5, this is like test rules in JUnit 4, where I would just pass the resources in a varg. And then under the hood, it would replace them in my dependency injection, which is pretty nice. If you want to know more, we don't have that time, but I just published a blog post about it 2 days ago. So go to the pro Android dev. What I also liked, and you probably could do the same in Dagger, right? You could load the graph and use actually dependency injection in your test. Inject the same thing, for example, which is pretty nice, and then you can manipulate it. Instead of overwriting something, inject the same thing and then check on the real thing. So it is really nice for testing. So, and I'm a testing guy, so I like this. So let's talk more about the transition. So as I said, we started with Toothpick, but it was a fresh application. Then Toothpick Kotlin extensions, and then from there, we moved the phone part. We started with Coin, just to see how it went. And then migrated also the TV part that was in Toothpick to Coin. And this is where we are right now. So things I learned. So if it's easy, how easy it is to change it depends a bit on how well your dependency injection is hidden, right? So at Groupon, actually the merchant app, at some point we migrated from Dagger 1 to Toothpick and took us a day. And then one day to clean it all up, the bugs we had. But it only was possible because it was very encapsulated. The problem is that it's a bit harder from the Java way to the Kotlin way. It is easier to move between them, right? Because, but your Wrapper, and we had this, helped us some points, but not in all of them. It's definitely will be really hard to replace all the add injects that you have in your constructors. So maybe start by using manual bindings first. So by using the providers, for example. What is actually nice, Codein has a reflection-based Java X inject implementation you can use. So you can keep working while you do this migration. But it is a lot of work if you have a large application and for a lot of data code. One thing that I learned that in the module definition and the bindings, you might end up with a little bit of awkward syntax. Because, yeah, you're giving like get. But also shows you some code smells, right? Maybe having six arguments here, there's something wrong. So that's actually a good thing. So which features you should actually look into if you want to decide for one of those frameworks? So probably you want to have tags or named. So add named is the one thing that Dagger had. It's possible definitely in Coin and Codein, you would pass it while you bind something, and in similar ways definitely when you ask for the delegate. So it is possible and not much different. Scoping, that's a big topic. So we fuse activity scopes and scope signal and stuff like this. It is supported, but this is where you should definitely, I would tell you, make a proof of concept. Because I realized that the definition of scopes are very different. And I know from other developers who moved to Coin that they run into problems because the way scopes are handled are a bit different there. So you can definitely define them. Here's scope for module, for Coin, Codein, and for the toothpick. I cannot show you Dagger code because we don't have the time. This is how you would use it in toothpick. A toothpick you would call open scope. And you know how you would use it in Coin? By inject. That's magic, because it will open the scope by itself. It will find, oh, I need this class. Oh, here it is. So it's in a scope. Let's open the scope. Which is a nice thing and a bad thing at the same time. What is nice about Coin, it's very easy. The hard thing is you cannot control some of the things. And as it finds it yourself, how do you define which one you want? You cannot, because it can only be one per scope. So you might have issues, and you only find those, I think, if you test it. This is nothing you can find easily in documentation. So I just said it, there are some scoping problems that got into Coin. Codein seemed to have solved all of this. The problem there is this Codein has 1,000 of delegates, I have the feeling. They're already in version 5.0, while Coin is not even 1.0. And there's a delegate for everything. Depends on if you like that. Find the right one, right? It's a huge documentation. Other features you might want to have, like an Android module to inject preferences, resources, stuff like this. Coin has direct support for architecture components, so you can have a by-view model. And they're working on lifecycle components right now. That is pretty nice. Multi-module, what about non-JVM Kotlin projects? Maybe you have like a Kotlin native thing. Can you use it? This is where Dagger definitely stops, right? So look at those. Coin and Codein are there. They have this. So to sum up, my suggestions is I like Coin because it's really, it has like, I think, three classes similar to Toothpick. It is super simple. The problem is it's super simple. So some things you might not have that you want. Codein has all of those. Just find the right delegate and teach your team how to use it. One of the things I don't like with Dagger is that it becomes so feature-rich. So choose your weapon, right? Choose your poison. But be reminded that dependency injection is actually a very easy concept. And that's why even with activity scope, sometimes it's like, that's really the thing. And adding more and more stuff as Android-specific tab into a dependency injection is just the way to go. It's dependency injection, it's creating an object. Don't make it like a framework. I mean, Dagger, one of the problems with Dagger for me is it became like RX Java. It is all over your app and you cannot get it out there anymore, right? But it's a library, it should be easy to replace. So give it a try, both on GitHub, they're all open source. If you want to try step by step, look at Toothpick and the Kotlin extensions are on our repo, talking to the developers to move them over. Also, some of the problems that we talked in the beginning can be solved over time in the annotation processors. I mean, of course, Dago and Toothpicker code, they know that Kotlin is there, right? So I know that Stefan and Daniel, the guys behind Toothpick, they're looking into generating Kotlin code. Then some of the things get obsolete that I talked about, right? You can use default arguments. But still, they're not there, right? There's a lot of blogs to read. These are the ones that they quoted, like from to start reading about Mark Zeman, Martin Fowler's blog, the history of dependency injection. If you disagreed with some of the parts, I just took it from there. And one migration from Corin. Thanks to Teresa, who built these nice drawings for me to make my slides more consistent. She couldn't join DroidCon because she got sick. And that was the talk. I'm not sure if we have time for questions, but thank you.